wonderful to be here with you today. I think this is a topic, as we can tell from how this room keeps getting full, that we're all dealing with at an increasing level. So it's a pleasure to share with you some of the things that we have done, maybe some ideas you can take. We're all noticing an increasing proportion of students who come in without what we would think of as the traditional qualifications for being music majors. A lot of them are very good musicians, although not what we used to call classical musicians or art musicians necessarily. They have great intuitive sorts of skills, but they know nothing about notation or traditional sorts of form and analysis. However, they're very, very interested in music. They love music and they want to pursue it. So how can we help them proceed better? A lot of these students are also first-generation students. They come from lower socioeconomic status levels. They have barriers in terms of traveling, in terms of paying for school, in terms of many things that hinder their ability to get to class on time or even get to campus for an entire day. A lot of these students are also not necessarily from traditional populations. In our particular area in West Texas, we're a majority-minority area, as the term goes. Most of our area is Hispanic. Most of our student population is Hispanic. And that comes with their own musical expectations and cultural traditions that we have to respect. Our students are also working more than perhaps ever before. I did a show of hands a couple of weeks ago in a choral rehearsal just because I wanted to get some anecdotal data. And I said, how many of you all are working a job outside of campus? And everybody raised their hand. How many of you all are working 10 hours or more? Most all the hands say that 15 hours or more. Still most of the hands, 20 hours or more. About 80% of the hands were still up. And these are full-time students. They're enrolled taking full-time loads and also working. They may have little to no background in art music, but they may have significant background in hip-hop or country or contemporary Christian, mariachi in our area, or many other kinds of music that come from their own particular backgrounds. They also tend to be very practically focused. They're very interested in how can this training help me to achieve my goals, to achieve the kinds of music that I would like to do, the kind of tasks that I would like to do. And they don't have quite as much patience for sitting through abstract training sessions on quarter notes twice, an eighth note is twice, a 16th, etc. They may have different individual or sort of corporate cultures that they come from in their own backgrounds. They also have very interesting individual playlists. An exercise that I love that I picked up from a dear colleague of mine, Todd Van Kegrix at the University of Houston, is ask your students, what are your top 10 things you listen to? Just write them down and then go find them. And you'll find an incredible array of music of all kinds, from video games, from rap, from hip hop, from country, from any of those genres, world music. We can still draw from these things concepts of rhythm, concepts of scale, concepts of solfege, of course, if it's still traditionally Western-based scale music. So how are we serving these individuals within our program? Several years ago, this was even before COVID, it's about 5 or 6 years ago, our theory team, we have a theory team at Wayland, and students and Scott Sprobus are a theory faculty, and they decided to throw out the book, literally, no textbook. We're going to build an approach that meets these students where they are and derives the content from the music that they listen to, and also includes some of the works of the traditional canon, Mozart, Beethoven, Wagner, all these things as well, as sort of highlights of, oh, by the way, you might like this, without necessarily centralizing them. So this is an integrated theory and oral skills approach where we have retained a 4-credit course that we call Craft and Rhetoric and Tonal Literature. There are 3 semesters of it. And they meet 5 days a week. There is no separate course or a separate lab day for oral skills. All of it is embedded in each day's material. So you can always hear every day throughout the course. It moves seamlessly from presentation material to working out material to doing oral skills, and even a little bit of keyboard that I'll hear coming down the hall. It's team taught, as I mentioned. Both Ann and Scott team teach this course and they split the load between them. And that creates a really wonderful dynamic for the students to see, of cooperation with the faculty, and also this sort of seamless back and forth of content with different voices. I think I came from an applied background, I'm a pianist myself, and it was always very nice to hear another perspective on something with a different voice, whether it was a master class or going and taking a lesson with somebody over the summer. And, you know, now we're able to do this team talk approach where they're hearing these different perspectives bouncing off each other back and forth, and it's very beneficial. As I said, this is repertoire based, but we're redefining what repertoire means. It's not, you know, necessarily Beethoven or even necessarily Gershwin. What are they listening to? What are we finding? One of my favorite days in the fall term in the introductory semester is Hey Jude Day. I'm sitting down in the hall of my office listening to the course, and the Beatles are playing in a room and they're solfeggio the bass line because that's how they're learning the basics of chord progression, the basics of do, fa, so, etc. And that's one example of many out of the curriculum that we use. We also integrate things like lead sheets or charts. There's a lot of jazz that I hear coming out of this course. A lot of worship music that is not notationally based as we sort of classically train people think about it. We've even learned to ask questions like, what does notation even really mean? If you've got a lead sheet in front of you, if you've got maybe the framework or something, but what if what you're doing changes from time to time, as it would in a repository-based style, such as jazz, contemporary Christian? This is a practically focused approach that seems to relate very well to what the students need in terms of what skill do I really need to go and be able to curate this piece of electronic music that's going to be an underscoring for the YouTube video that my friend and art major is working on, or any number of projects similar to that. This also leads to much better retention among the students, and also much better integration of concepts around what they're doing, not only in the classroom, but in their applied work and their ensemble work. When they're going into their choral rehearsals, we'll actually make sure to coordinate with our choral director and say, what are you working on this semester? Maybe there's something we can use to illustrate pandiatonicism or polyrhythms or some sort of concept that we might be able to reinforce in the classroom. And then they're all automatically thinking about both things as they're going back and forth down the hall. Then the applied studio, the same way. Have you thought about how this aria actually is decoupled for? Or this verse-chorus-verse-chorus form as these elements of macro form that we're already learning in our courses. One of the phrases I love that our theory faculty gave me to sort of highlight is that methodology is transcending content. It's not that the content isn't important, it's that the methodology is what you use to approach content. And that also completely broadens the base of what content means. If you teach somebody the methodology of how do you look at a piece or listen to a piece and think about, okay, I hear form, I hear a period, I hear an 8-measure phrase, I hear a 16-measure period, I hear, etc. I hear this chord motion, I hear this vertical motion, I hear this layer of rhythmic devices. This can be applied to all kinds of things that they're listening to, not just an exercise that takes place in theory class on Tuesday morning. There is a holistic experience of form and structure that results from this approach. And then we get down to note-by-note analysis as necessary. From there, we're able to see a joy come out of the students that we're meeting them in their space, and we're saying, this is really cool music you're listening to. Let's explore it more. Last thing I'll say is that I relate to this with my own children. I'm an 8th grader, a 6th grader. They love things like Geometry Dash. They love watching YouTube videos. They love, you know, electronically inspired music that comes out of video games and all of these things. Incredibly layered music, incredibly rhythmically complex, very creative things with all kinds of sounds that cannot be traditionally notated. And if we have the students that want to dive into this, how are we helping them be able to do this? It's a tremendously exciting thing that we're able to do. So hopefully that's a bit of a snapshot of some methodologies or ideas that relate to our students as a whole. And thank you very much for allowing me to share a little bit of our methodology.
Any questions for Dr. Townsend? Do all of your students take the same 4-semester sequence of that kind of class?
Our sequence is actually sort of a 3+1. We have 3 semesters of the Craft and Rhetoric course, and then the 4th semester they take Common Practice Masterworks, which is sort of the what might traditionally be called the first semester of music history. In the 3rd semester of Craft and Rhetoric, we're actually layering 20th century history into it. So we're also teaching history and theory at the same time there, so they can see the interacting context of theory and history in those works. So the theory as such is the 3 semesters.
What's the meeting pattern for such a
course?
Robust integrated course.
Sorry, could you define the question?
So, how often do you meet? How long?
Oh.
Because you mentioned an integration of at least 3 different courses, or what many of us do is 3 different courses.
Right. This course meets 5 days a week for 50 minutes each, 50 minutes. I should say that the introductory history course is a separate course, but we do the first 2 semesters of Craft and Rhetoric are much like Theory 1, Theory 2, but then the 3rd semester is where we're integrating 20th century history into it, and then we have the separate, in the 4th semester, they'll take a Common Practice Masterworks course.
I think I heard you muting it and saying that you get down to note-by-note considerations when necessary. As a rule, you generally start with larger chunks of music and your articulations, and actually then work down with a smaller kind of a scaffold approach?
Generally, yes, because we're, again, trying to think, how are we experiencing music? Let's start from there. And then as we dive down, we start to discover, oh, okay, if you notate this, this is chord noting, et cetera. And then you can also talk about harmonic analysis and things on a more granular level. But we start with a larger experience, yes.
How do you handle the difference between students coming in at very different levels, some who have no notational experience, and some who are very well
versed? Great question. We do occasionally have somebody who's come through AB theory or a very high level sorts of instruction, a Texas Allstate, you know, singer. Sometimes, believe it or not, we have to unlearn them a little bit. You probably experience this a lot in your faculties. Theory faculty always have their own vocabularies that are very intimidating. Ours are not dissimilar, but we also are wanting them to be integrated with their cohort. And so even the very high level people still have their own playlist, and they still have things they like to listen to. So then they may be familiar with some other things that are in a broader context, but we can still say, you can also apply this to maybe the music you listen to for fun. You haven't thought of analyzing it yet. So we try to make sure that we're balancing everybody as much as we can in those ways.
Thank you for that question. It's actually a really good segue into our next presentation. So I know there's a couple more questions, but if we can move on, and then we'll have time for questions at the end as well. So let me just handle technology, which is always a challenge for me. It's my pleasure to introduce to you Nicholas Shea. Dr. Shea is actually an assistant professor at Arizona State University School of Music and Theater, so I hired him. His primary work studies how musicians from diverse backgrounds conceptualize and execute various components of musical structure through performance using techniques such as behavioral experiments, corpus studies, and theoretical analysis. He has 2 publications that are recent off the press, Gestural Perspectives on Popular Music Performance in the Music Theory Online Journal, and then The Feel of the Guitar in Popular Music Performance, also in the Society of Music Theory Journal, so video journal. He earned his PhD at Ohio State, his master's at UMass Amherst. There's a typo on our website that I discovered today, so that's always fun. And then a bachelor's at music ed from University of Missouri, St. Louis. He's from St. Louis, so he's getting Thanksgiving with the parents on the school. So.
Thank you. is a topic that's like very dear to my heart, and I think about this a lot. It keeps me up at night, and I'm really thrilled to get a chance to talk to you all about this, especially at the end of the session when we start workshopping these issues. My talk is going to focus more on curricular development and some of these bigger picture things. My goal is by the end of the session to give you some concrete strategies that you can use in your own curricula to help these diverse music majors. So I'm going to get right into it. So I'm going to start off with talking a little bit about the ethical imperative of remediation, what's at stake, and then I'm going to move on to specifications grading and talking about specific remediation tracks. And then I'll wrap up with a quick demonstration of protonotation and how I use it to foster these remediation strategies in my classroom. So historical expectations, and Richard touched on this a little bit. When they come into a school of music, you know, historically we've expected students come in an orchestral instrument or with voice. They have some fluency in Western staff notation. And previously we had a more limited pool of majors, right? In a contemporary setting, we focus and we are inclusive of music production broadly defined. So if you can produce music, you're in. We have lower fluency barriers and we've expanded majors. I think we can all agree that this is the landscape that we're in right now. I'm just going to talk anecdotally about ASU specifically. So at ASU we have a pretty high acceptance rate for the school itself, it's 88.4%. We are a Hispanic-serving institution, and at the School of Music, we have a diverse diverse range of majors with diverse musical backgrounds. So this includes music therapy, popular music production, music theater, audition students, community college transfer students. And ultimately, this results in a wide range of abilities at Theory 1, in Theory 1 specifically, which I coordinate. So the thing I want to make clear today is that as we expand our range of majors in schools of music, we are ethically obligated to support non-traditional students. We are ethically obligated to support non-traditional students. And why is this? Well, number one is that failing music theory sets students back, right? It sets them back in their degree progress. Non-traditional students also have higher burden of cost, typically, regarding college admission. And then they also, as Richard mentioned, have less experience on how to college, is how I like to call it. They have less experience navigating expectations of higher education. So how can we support these non-traditional students? Soon we're gonna hear about some low-cost materials and how to diversify content. And then Richard touched a little bit on mentorship. Today I'm gonna be talking about setting crystal clear expectations for students, developing remediation tracks, and scaffolding skill building within the Theory 1 curriculum specifically. But this also applies to other materials as well. The main resource that I pull from, and I've been reading a lot from, is this text called Specifications Grading, Restoring Rigor, Motivating Students, and Saving Faculty Time. This is by Linda B. Nielsen. I really recommend you all pick up a copy of this book. We don't have the time to dive into all of the aspects of this text, but the main things that I'm going to focus on from this are how to tie outcomes to grades, so classroom outcomes to grades, talk about developing grading tracks, and how these tracks offer built-in remediation opportunities. And then ultimately, the advantage of this is for students, you get out what you put in, and we're going to talk about that as we move forward. All right, so tying outcomes to grades. Theory is ultimately a skills-based course, and I think you all would agree that we don't always feel comfortable moving students on if you aren't fluent in certain aspects, right? If you don't meet certain benchmarks. So the thing I would like you all to do is think about the outcomes that are required for a C in your course. For me, these are some of them, not all of them, but there's spelling triads and a key, no reading in at least two clefs, sight singing a diatonic melody, dictating a medium-length melody, and harmonizing a sentence or a period. These are the things I would expect students to be able to do by the end of Theory 1. So here's an example of a grade track. And I've, disclaimer, I integrate some of these, I'm slowly integrating more of these, okay? So this is a gradual process, and this is not something that can happen, or should happen immediately, I think, personally. So a C track for me might look like this, where you pass three or four sight singing assessments, you pass a final dictation exam, you score a 70% on a fundamentals exam, usually offered around like week six. Score a 2 out of 3 on most in-class quizzes. That's a C track. A B track would be all of the above, but also complete all homework at a rate of 70%. So an average of 70%. You have to complete all the homework and you get an average of 70% for that homework. And then an A-track might include finishing a final composition or project that is sort of the cherry on top of all of these other things that you would have to accomplish. And you can imagine how this might simplify grading a little bit too in classes that are very large, which is my course as well. Regarding remediation, when you integrate, when you create tracks like these, the instructor has a couple of obligations. Instructor is required to offer makeups for sightseeing and the fundamentals exam. So for sightseeing, students have a week. If they fail a sightseeing, they get a try again grade instead of a fail grade. And then they have a week to meet with me or a TA to come back and show me that they understood the concepts from that week. And then the fundamentals exam I offer on each subject, and this is something that I offer at the end of the semester. We actually did it on Friday. We offered our fundamentals exam retake. And that's an opportunity for them to prove to me that they are fluent in the things that they just might have needed more time with. And then there's also a student-driven component of this where students can earn makeups via attendance, so they can make up homework. Say they missed one and forgot to turn one in, or say they did poorly on a quiz. Students earn a token, and you can make this as complicated as you'd like, but students earn a token for every 2 weeks of class attended, and then they exchange that token for a makeup, like a homework assignment makeup or a quiz makeup. Okay, so let's pivot to a practical example of helping a non-traditional student. We're gonna call this student X. Student X is a popular music production major, cannot discern contour or even sing a major scale, and has little to no fluency in staff notation. And by the way, this sounds negative, but I wanna tell you that student X is also an excellent hip hop producer. They're just so great, and they're always featured on our popular music Instagram, and I'm like, woo, go student X, right? But this student has a certain, we might call them deficiencies related to a traditional music theory curriculum, right? And so ultimately, student X needs instructor or expert level support and just needs more time to get familiar with notation, right? So how do we help student X? Well, ultimately, specification grading creates a contract between students and instructors. Student X has to attend class regularly. They can't miss more than four classes. They have to work consistently with a TA or a tutor. That TA or tutor signs off and says, hey, yeah, student X has worked with me off and on throughout the semester. And they also have to have a check-in meeting with me near the beginning of the semester. And me, on my end, I agree to offer a makeup for the fundamentals exam, which I already do. But instead of doing these weekly makeups for sightseeings, I actually just do all of the student sightseeings at the end of the semester, because this student needs way more help than a student who can sing a major scale, for example, right? So I meet with the student at the very end and I say, student X, let's sing all these melodies and let's see where you're at and if you are at a passing level. Okay, so I'm gonna pivot now to the notation part of this, which is the other aspect of this. I'm gonna breeze through this, but the book is RL Skills Acquisition by Gary Karpinski. And I'm gonna be talking about protonotation as a scaffolded notation technique. Protonotation is ultimately just a cognitive framework for dictation. If you think about staff notation is messy. You need clef, key, bottom number of the meter sign. There are so many opportunities for errors, but as you'll see with protonotation, it's a simplified framework, and you mostly need to just focus on meter, rhythm, and solfege, and the functional relationship between pitches. So I'm going to give you an example. So sol, fa, mi, re, do, re, mi, fa, sol, mi. Okay, so say you heard that, but it was lu, 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 lu. Say you ask a student to dictate that. First, I would have them focus on the meter. Their metric framework looks something like this, a series of vertical dashes that indicate the beats and the grouping. So this is a triple meter, right? Simple triple meter. Then students would use horizontal dashes to show the proportion of the notes within that meter. So lu, 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 lu. And then the last thing I would have them do is use their knowledge of the scale to add solfege to this, and they add solfege above this. What's excellent about this protonotation framework, and what you will see, is that with just a little bit more information, it scaffolds very well into staff notation. So I would tell the student, okay, bass clef, F is your tonic, and there's a 4 on the bottom number of the meter. computer science. And what ultimately they could produce, if they do so correctly, would be an example like this. And here you can see that the bar lines line up with the bar lines on the staff notation, something like this. Or this is also an acceptable answer, right? Either of these hearings are correct, right? Either of these hearings are correct. And regarding protonotation, just a couple things about this to create a non-punitive system. I only grade protonotation for the first semester, only the protonotation. And then I grade in chunks rather than note by note. I give feedback only on staff notation. And then if the class struggles with one particular kind of dictation, I give them a chance to revise and reflect instead of just penalizing the class for not understanding something. All right, and this is my last slide. I'll just wrap this up. So in summary, I believe we have an ethical obligation for remediation as schools of music expand the kinds of musicians we accept into our institutions. Specifications grading sets a clear expectation for students. It ties outcomes to grade tracks, has built-in remediation opportunities, and it simplifies grading and benchmark evaluations. And then finally, I recommend protonotation because it's a non-punitive system for building notational fluency. Thank you all. So I worked with Gary Karpinski at UMass Amherst, and I think some folks know this, but I don't think it's actually very widely implemented.
And secondly, as a follow-up, when I look at it, it looks a lot like a DAW-based composition.
It does.
So does that then translate better to those students?
This is why I love it, right? So meter ends up being very clearly organized, and then also you can really see the proportion of the notes, right? And then when students get there, it takes about 60 seconds for them to eventually transfer into staff notation. Yeah. That's good too. Yeah, meta notation. Good. Sure.
So when you give makeups, do you feel like students are, hey, I know he'll give me the makeup, so I don't need to work as hard on this first one?
Yeah, that's a tough line to toe. Yeah, you're right. And so actually, I don't always advertise that. They know that they can make up the fundamentals exam. We talk about that otherwise. Otherwise, we sort of touch it on a case-by-case basis, especially for the students who need lots of extra help. But then otherwise, like I mentioned here, like if they all bomb a dictation, that's when I give them the makeup. I don't advertise that I'm going to give them makeups for everything. Right.
Yeah. Thank you.
Oh, and the sight singing. The sight singing is assumed too. So if you do bomb it, you get a chance within a week. Yeah. Yes, please.
Nick, do you ever think about it if it's possible that you have a large class of divided students out by section or working groups and pluses, minuses, and that sort of thing?
Yeah. That's a good question. So I currently have 6 RL skills TAs, and they lead the RL skills sections. And it depends. And some I like to actually switch it up. I think that's a question maybe we could address later. But it's kind of complicated. But you're right. That's another factor as well. Why don't we go over here and then over here?
I'm just curious if your sight singing assessments are public, like they do them in class in front of each other.
Yeah, so they're at the end of the class, and so they'll be like, you know, these 3 students hang back, we're going to sing. And so they do sing in front of those 2 other students, but they're not public. And then the makeups are through the magic of Zoom. The students, my TAs, just pull up an excerpt. And so on Fridays, they have like Friday office hours, and they have to meet with their TAs during those Friday office hours. Yeah.
I'm just curious, is this something you only use at the lower levels, or do you use it later? Because I use a lot of protonotation.
Yeah.
And throughout musicianship, like when I introduce a new concept, like 16th note syncopation, we go right back to protonotation.
Yeah.
I just keep having to use
So I mean, I like using it in theory too, still, when I do like revisiting the dictations, but I'm not actually in charge of theory through 3 and 4. So I have a conversation with my colleagues, but I do encourage it, especially in popular music contexts, right? Because this is so much more helpful. I kind of hate the quarter note dogma that exists in popular music because it's undernoted, right? And this is more equitable, in my opinion.
So, since you've been doing this, what's the retake, theory retake level? What's the percentage?
I had about, are you asking the number of students that actually took it?
Type here.
I had about 30 students out of my 90 student class come back and do the fundamentals exam pre-take.
Okay, and do they repeat the course also?
No, they don't.
Okay, so this has cut down, I guess, on the number of students who are retaking the course.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. We want to, again, some students simply need more time to reach a fluency benchmark, and so I basically kick back the fundamentals exam, allow them to retake it, so that way they can prove to me that they've spent the time on the relevant skills. I'm probably going to get kicked off, but I'd be happy to chat with you all after the session, okay? Thank you, Barry.
Good job.
Brian has been teaching music theory and musicianship for over 20 years at 8 universities across the U.S. and is currently lecturer of music theory and composition at San Jose State University and the co-founder, assistant director, and instructor of piano, music theory, composition, and piano improvisation at the Hunter School of Music in San Jose. As a faculty special consultant at San Jose State, Brian has created a refreshed, more inclusive music theory and musicianship curriculum, which aims to balance the works of the classical canon with works of student musical icons in the classroom. Let's welcome Dr. Brian.
Thank you very much. Great to be here among great colleagues. So what I'm talking about today is resources for teaching. I have an extensive list of things to share with you. Before I get into that, I don't know if you all remember buying a counterpoint book way back when you were an undergraduate or graduate student, spending about $90 on this little red book, right? You can remember that. All of these resources, pretty much all of them, are free. So gone perhaps in the days of spending $500 on textbooks. I think this is a great thing for students that we teach and ourselves.
Could you expand the font?
Oh, sure. Is that better?
Much, said the old people.
And I hope to share this with you all. It's a Google Doc, so it's a shareable. This is not a, certainly not an end-all, be-all list. I'm still learning. New resources are constantly being discovered. These are just the ones that I've been introduced to as of late. And so I'm just gonna get right into it. The first group, group one, are listings, databases of musical examples of BIPOC composers, women composers, and LGBTQ composers as well. So let me show you how this works. If you haven't seen it before, I'll guide you through it. If you have, apologies in advance. The first example is a piece by, well, here's the list, music theory examples by BIPOC composers up here. And it's exhaustive, it's great. And let me show you how great it is. So if you're teaching the common tone to a seventh chord, for example, you need a great example. That's, Mozart, right? I have a great example by Nathaniel Depp. Here you have the listing, African-American composer, Canadian, American. Here's a Wikipedia page about him. The piece Magnolias from the Magnolia Suite for Piano, the year of composition, 1912. Where is the common tone diminished seventh chord in the piece throughout? Ethnicity here, also the actual IMSLP score, the YouTube link, et cetera, et cetera. And sort of a synopsis of how the music theory is included within that. Yeah, other details as well. I want to show you that. So here is the YouTube link to Magnolias, and here's the piece. can see the common tone in Minnesota, put it right in here, that D is the common tone there. Right, so just an example of how accessible and easy it is to use this in your teaching. Another resource, Composers of Color Resource Project. This one's a little less comprehensive than the first one, but it has lesson plans of the featured works. I find that useful. And the scores, so that one's pretty good. Okay, you can see here scores by composers of color, annotated scores, etc., lesson materials. So I find this pretty useful. I actually don't use the lesson plans. I like to do it myself, but if you need it, it's there. Ideas are great. Study other lesson plans and learn from it, right? And they actually hear those notes there, analytical notes from source of composers of color. And I think this is a growing list here. They do this kind of analysis, a-thon. It's kind of interesting, composers of color. And so it's kind of interesting to see this done. Done. That's great. Done. I kind of love that. It's really inspiring. And so here's another one, expanding the music theory canon. This is, it seems like it features not only BIPOC composers, but women. So you can see all the portions there. It's beautiful. This one, to give you sort of an inside scoop here, it has scores, basic theory topics, and bios. They're all sort of different. We don't have bios for this this middle one, because of color. But, so they each have their own sort of features. And finally, diverse music theory examples, also BIPOC composers and women. This one, I believe, it's just topical, so you have topics with lists of works and composers. So these are some resources that I like to use. And let me go on to textbooks now. These are all free. This year at San Jose State, we adopted the Hutchinson text, which I really, really like. But I'm thinking of perhaps moving also to Artusi. Let me talk about those. So Hutchinson is really great because, well, I'll just show you how great it is. So this semester in Music Theory 3, we talked about modulation. And what better way to start modulation with some Beyonce? There's also Bon Jovi, there's the James Horner song, My Heart Will Go On from the Titanic. But it's not just popular music. I think this is a way to get students hooked on this content, draw them in using their icons in the classroom. And if you go to the next slide, in fact, there's a balance in this textbook of the Beyonce type of music, the pop music, and Bach and Schumann. So as you go through, you get Schubert, Schwanengesang, and of course the Christmas Oratorio down here. By the famous chorale. So you get a balance here, which I really like. So this textbook's great. The other great thing about it, the text is succinct. The students get like a little bit to read. It's right to the point. So when they're looking at this, they're like, oh, I can handle that. And also, the examples are just, you know, numerous. They're riddled throughout the reading. So they get a little bit of text, okay, the topic's introduced, and then the examples right away. And the YouTube, as you heard, the YouTube links are queued up right away. So you don't have to scroll through. So this is a great resource for teaching. I use this semester, it's excellent. And the practice exercises at the end have an answer key right away. So students pop in the answers and they see the answer, and they get immediate feedback. So I like this one. This is the Hutchinson text. Another great text that I just discovered that I'd like to try to use next year is Artusi. This is the so-called Interactive Music Fundamentals. This is great for orals and music theory. I'll show you why it's great for music theory. Look at this right here. There is an interactive sort of inputting of content. So the students read a little bit. Let me zoom in a little bit so you can see this. Students read some content, and then right away there is an exercise in the textbook. It's interactive, and that's a really great thing. You get feedback right away with the content that they just read. And you can also see down here overall progress in green and red, and they can see how they're doing with the content. If they need to review something, they can go back. So that's a great textbook there. So moving ahead, this is a new book, Open Music Theory. This one actually shows students how to draw clefs. I thought that was really interesting. From the ground up, that one. And Everyday Tonality by Tag. This is a good book. It's a little bit verbose, and it doesn't have examples, but I like it because it's sort of like approaching everything universally. Well, it's all on the same page. And then Philip Ewell has a textbook coming out in 2023, The Engaged Musician, and I look forward to this, so I can't wait for this to come out. Other resources, I use Musician and Aurelia. Free notation software, Teria, which is pretty good, but I will say the MIDI is not so good. It's a general MIDI, so there's a little bit lacking in that respect. I think Musician and Aurelia are a little bit better in terms of the actual MIDI files. So let me move on. Let me try to finish up here. My students do a final project that we call the Inclusion Initiative at San Jose State. So they write a piece in my theory class, a composition that's collaborative. So they work in a group of four musicians. And they write a piece based on a poem or a work of art, a painting by a BIPOC or woman poet. And so they bring it together, they compose together. It's a great way to be inclusive. And they do it in the software called Flat. And this is actually a collaborative, sort of the Google Docs of music notation. So they can work together at different, you know, locales. So I really like this Flat MuseScore, of course. And then finally, what I do for my classes is create playlists of the pieces that we study. And just look at this playlist. You've got Josquin, Mozart, Aha, Keith Jarrett, Palestrina, theme from Love Story, the Allegri, Samuel Coleridge Taylor, NBC Chime, West Side Story, D. Joe, Chateau, Dr. Dre, Still Dre, Beethoven, Nat King Cole, Bob Marley, and Paul McCartney. That is diverse. Right? So, and I make these playlists, by the way, it's called OMG This Playlist. trying to keep it light. Yeah, this is actually a playlist that students can listen to and immerse themselves in the repertoire we study in class. Yeah, so I guess I'll wrap it up there. I'll make this shareable for... Go back to my doc.
And scroll to the bottom. There you go.
Okay. Yeah, I'll share this with you. And please share your ideas with me, too.
Technology are you obviously there? What kind of technology are you bringing into the classroom then? Are students able to get on the iPad? Everybody's got one, and you kind of work that way?
Yeah, exactly. I have an iPad too, and I like to use the iPad because I can just sit at the piano. It makes it easy, but students, they use iPads, laptops like this one, all sorts of whatever they need.
When you're doing assessments, how are you evaluating them? Are they writing something down for you on paper and handing it in? I mean, how's that work?
Yeah, they do any number of things, from dictations at home to writing chorales. I have students do 3 chorales per semester, and they do them by hand. That's all handwritten notation for the most part, but some students, the composers especially, like to use the notation software. So, all of the above. Yes, sir.
A lot of the items are free musician Aurelia. There is a cost associated with this.
Yeah, that's.
Do you do that sort of like a required textbook or an optional resource for the students? Do you test them through that?
I do, yeah. The only thing that we make students purchase is the Aurelia musician. It's $59 for a year. We use that. I use that for dictations, and it's really handy because any homework assignment that's a dictation is automatically graded and integrated with Canvas, so it goes right into the grade. But what I do with that is I have a practice dictation first, and then a graded dictation, and so they have multiple opportunities to practice for the grade.
I would say for anyone who's interested, if you're worried that your students don't have a laptop or a tablet, that there's a PDF on the website that you can download. And so what I'll do is I'll send it to the print shop, and then they have a bound version you can give to the students so that they have a physical copy too. And then I also just put my laptop on the screen so I can show them and teach from it while I have their book too.
Yeah, that's great. I do the same. I put the PDF on Canvas for students who don't have laptops. Thanks for that.
Yeah. I just have a very practical question. I think we all would love to have your slides, everyone. Would it help if we took attendance and
sure.
Email all of us so you don't get 1,000 emails?
I'm down with that. You want to just, but okay, with one caveat. All y'all in the bright like doctor. Go back to first grade with penmanship lecture. Because I've already deciphered a couple. Yeah.
I'm just assuming that Brian's more tech savvy than us writing all our emails down.
Well,
you want to create something really quickly where you just.
Yeah, I'll
put a form up or something.
Yeah,
I'm just saying like a QR code.
Yeah, this link here is shareable. And so I'll just share.
Yeah.
QR code. You can edit it.
Yeah. Sharing a QR code.
Okay.
So
I have a question.
It's 2022.
It's still a dinosaur.
If you move the cursor, then probably there you go. No, like get off.
If it's not wanting to focus, tap on the QR code on your screen and it'll focus in for you.
So we have about 20 minutes left, and we wanted to break into some smaller groups with the 6 of us. So we need 6 groups of 10 to 12 people in each around the room. So if we could do that, I have 3 questions for you that I'm going to put up on the screen once everybody's has their QR scan. And then I'll get Nick to do a QR for this, and we'll put that up on the. Oh, it's right up here. But we'll put it up on the screen.
Sure.
Brian, do you have a version of this that
our choices. We can break into some small groups and have some smaller discussion, or we can just pose the questions to the whole group. Would you like that better?
Yes.
Okay. While we're dealing with the QR codes, because we're going to have Nick's slides up for you as well. That's not my
password.
So the first question I have for you is, what are the areas where you see students struggling the most in theory? What areas do you see students struggling the most? Secondary dominance.
Converting notation into sound.
Yes, converting notation into sound. Yeah.
Application of it in real life.
Applications in real life. Sort of like math.
Converting sound into notation.
Remembering
the melody
and predicting. Remembering the melody and predicting.
Yes.
Hey, I'm with that. So, with the caveat that they have lecture smaller discussion.
RL skills breakout sections, that's true. But they meet with me specifically for the music theory lecture on Tuesdays and Thursdays for an hour and 10 minutes.
Ours are between, you know, 6 and 10. We're a small private institution, so.
Can I follow up on the 90 in the class? Like, how do you deal with grading in that?
This, what I presented today, specifications grading. So if you check out the book, it also gives you some pass-fail strategies. I do a lot of things qualitatively. Like, I think you all know what a good sight singing is and a poor sight singing is, right? And so, like, I just do like A, B, C, or try again. And then if a grade is try again, then I allow them to make it up. And in addition to like homework assignments, they're very short, right? And they only have a couple questions. And then similarly, we do these things called in-class assessments. So I don't know if you all have ever read the book, Make It Stick, The Science of Successful Learning. But basically it says like you do low stakes remediation on a consistent basis. And so we do a like in-class, they're not quizzes, but in-class 5-minute assessment every day. And those are modeled just like the quizzes. That's how I meet my frequency benchmarks. And they're so easy to grade that the TAs usually can get them to the end, to the students, back to the students by the end of the classroom or end of the class session. But it is a lot. And that's why I've had to come up with creative strategies like the specification training.
So you do have TAs also grade?
I do, yes, that is correct. But there are some things that I grade my 6 TAs, and there are some things that I grade like the dictation exams, because I have the expertise, right? And they need at some point they need my expertise as well. So yeah, thanks for asking.
For Nick, again, with the 90 and then breakout sections for the TAs, what are the size of those sections?
It's great. With 6, we get like about 20, which I think is really manageable. And so that allows us to get anywhere from 4 to 5 sets of meetings for each student throughout the semester, which is usually my benchmark. It's about 20, 25.
Question for Brian. You have those pop music examples. Like demonstrating a key change or secondary dominant. Is there a way to assess that students can detect that when they're listening?
When you change clothes.
I think the proper assessment would be whether or not they're wearing a top hat. If their eyebrows go up. In the RL, I would be able to assess that in the RL's room. Musicianship and do a harmonic dictation. Have them do the baseline, if they could at least get the baseline, to go up a whole step or a half step, I think that would indicate a lot. Or even if they could say, yeah, put an asterisk where something occurs, that's a start, and then we can talk about how you can hear the interval. I do something where I have them I say pause or freeze the music and sing the interval that you hear back and forth. What does it match up? What tune does it match up with, right? Does it sound like Happy Birthday, or does it sound like the Mozart, the Jaws, or for the half step? And so that you'd be able to tell based on that reference tune what the interval is, and then plug that into the harmonic dictation, things like that. Yeah. So.
I think it's mostly a question for you, and I'm targeting it.
Richard.
But it's a little bit closer to all of yours, right? So there's. You guys have done some great examples of like expanding the repertoire of examples, right? You did that, right? A lot of that is still a little bit geared towards sort of teaching the same concepts with, right? And that's not a problem, right? Because that's definitely one way to do it. And there's a lot of music that still works like that, to be honest, I remember. But then there's also like just the real increase. The way that music works now, right, is like driven by layers and it's driven by timbre in a way that, so I guess within yours, then you're like, trying to like tell about Alan Moore and his functional layers and stuff, right? And which is very cutting edge theory, and it's cool, but so I wonder to the extent, are you guys using like spectrograms to talk about the timbre, or are you trying to grapple with that sort of like?
I can talk about it.
Yeah.
Sure.
All right.
Go ahead.
I think at this point it's mostly getting them to define what they're hearing, and whether, if it's a discrete pitch, great, and then we start talking about, you know, what we think of as traditional oral skills. And to the extent that most all of this stuff, unless it is really from some alternate cultures, like some, you know, classical Indian music or things that use alternate structures of scales, you know, like Byzantine chants and these microtones, this sort of thing.
if it's based in the Western scale, we can still go back and do solfege, and it still works with Beyonce, it still works with, you know, even a lot of the hip hop things with the layers. We bring in a theremin from time to time and talk about sort of, the THX sound, you know, the old movie thing where there's that expanding just range. Is it the Penderecki thing that we all learned in music history class versus these layers of gradually rising and falling sound? I don't know. It's a great question. I bet my theory prof would love to bring in a spectrograph, and he would have a lot of fun with it. But I don't know that we put that like formally in there. But we do talk a lot about just, okay, how do you define what you're listening to? Because again, it's trying to take, you know, it's about taking that methodology and putting it into whatever content you want to do with it.
Well, and to chime in on that, I totally agree that especially if you're going to fold in more popular music, I think that you have to be careful to make sure that your classical music rules aren't at least implied to be generalizing the popular music. And I think you all, I'm sure you all know this. Foremost, I think it's important to define your scope. At the beginning of Theory 1, I'm like, we are talking about mostly about popular music this semester, and then we are also talking about and the generalizable characteristics that could potentially carry over to classical music in Theory 2. So that's really important. And then, but you spend some time on non-harmonic parameters. Like, we do 2 weeks of meter. We do I don't know if you all are familiar with like the meter dot diagrams. I have the students create those to actually visualize instrument layers. So like if you think about Mariah Carey's All I Want Is Christmas Is You, it's like da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da, right? It's a quadruple compound meter, and there's a bunch of different instrument layers that are sort of supporting each of those layers. And so I make students in the first 2 weeks talk about that, and then they get a pretty clear idea of what compound meter looks like, right? And then related to your question on spectrogram, in Theory 4 specifically, this is where we get into those sort of like more timbral techniques. We actually hired a timbre specialist, Dr. Lindsay Remore, and she has a great curriculum for all those things, and I'd be happy to chat with you and point you into the direction. I will also say, if you are interested in timbre, the McGill has an actor lab, which is the analysis and creation or teaching of orchestration and timbre or something like that. And they have a bunch of pedagogical resources for teaching timbre as well.
That's great. I know you said they could make up those exams if they're not pass it. How early do you take it in the semester?
Yeah. So I originally had my fundamentals exam at 4 weeks, and I realized that was way too soon. And so I do 6 weeks now. And then we have a 17-week semester, is that correct? 15, and then a finals week, right? So at week 14, I allow them to retake the fundamentals exam, basically right before the add drop deadline, so that they have a way, that they have a pretty clear idea of where they stand. And my fundamentals exam is organized around scales, rhythm and meter, key signatures, and intervals, and then they can make up each component. So even if they got a 9 out of 10, and they want to earn that one extra point, I let them make it up. In my 90-person class, I had about 30 students show up, and were really invested in sort of proving to me that they are fluent in those areas at the end of the semester. And to be clear, I let all students make that up at the end. So.
Is that the only assessment you give during the semester?
No, I have other unit tests. And speaking of like deprioritizing like classical voice leading and techniques and stuff like that, like one of them is just like compose background vocals for this chord progression. That would be an example of like a unit exam, right? Thanks.
Our last question for you. What ideas do you have based on today's session? Or based on the conversation? What ideas came up for you?
I was thinking about changing my textbook, and I'm going to change my textbook.
Awesome.
Starting with larger chunks of music and then working beyond to smaller music.
Peter.
We sort of accepted the premise, because of who we all are, that protonotation was a step to, quote, real notation.
Right.
We should take a beat with that. Right? Chester said, oh, that's like a dog. And the protonotation could just be notation, right? That we sort of routed to what we know is a moment to reflect. You know?
Yeah,
obviously, if you don't know what dog is, then you don't know the language that a lot of people do.
Right.
Right.
A dog is, Chester?
What?
What's a dog?
Digital audio workstation. Garage band.
But it was just interesting to see the room, like, think that the protonotation, like, okay, we're halfway there. And for a whole bunch of our musicians, you're done.
Yeah. Well, and that's why, like, on my Canvas materials, I take care to say Western staff notation every time I say it. I don't say notation. I don't say real music, right?
Yeah, because
you're absolutely right. There's a different kind of representing music.
So do students have the experience to make a beat or to improvise over a beat or to sing from a lead sheet? Are we centering other systems for all the students in these classes?
I mean, there are opportunities to do, like in theory too, it's more of our classical music oriented, and we do it two and a half weeks on flow and rap, and then they get a chance to do these sort of things, like to break up. But the answer is, do I do it all the time? No, unfortunately I don't. But we do have this popular music program where they do this all the time. They're doing this in other classes, you know what I mean?
Yeah, so the popular music theory track is the first two semesters of the core, and then two semesters of popular music core, right? So they attend, I think, teaching that next semester, the popular music theory course. So that's all I have to end up being.
Yes, can I ask, what happens textbook-wise in theory three, and are those three and four at each of your institutions?
Currently, we use the Berkowitz, the Saul Berkowitz. And we use that for melody, singing, prepared singing. And so students use that for both years of their curriculum. But yeah, that's the only book that they currently have to purchase. So there's that, but I use a lot of actual, like I use the same content from the theory course to the RLs course. I say, hey guys, and I'll trick them. And I have a dictation, it's the same tune we just did, we analyzed, and they don't even know it. I'm like, guys, we just did this in the theory class, and you know, here's the same thing. And so, yeah, there's a lot of like transfer in the courses. So I'm in the theory four course because Berkowitz, in my opinion, doesn't have enough Schoenberg and, you know, the atonal stuff. I just draw from the theory course and I use the same content. So they sing Schoenberg 12-tone melodies, you know, for example, and other things. That's my content.
I use the Erskine and Strauss just because it's so concise, and it's also relatively low cost. It's not the most low cost, but I was at Ohio State. Anna Galboy made all the teaching videos, and I think they're an excellent resource. So you're like, if the student doesn't understand, I don't know how to build a triad, there's a 2-minute video I can send them to watch too. And so I do understand the barrier of cost. We also supplement with a musician, and then we use the Rogers and Hotman for sight singing. And like I mentioned in theory one, we focus on sight singing as like building a skill in a low stakes setting. So they prepare melodies from the Rogers and Ottman, but I actually give them Karpinski melodies to sing. Like I just have scans of that. And then similarly, all of our dictation materials are from Karpinski because they're designed in such a way to help facilitate chunking and like all these skills that you need, like inferring the tonic, right, metric organization and stuff like that. So we're actually, it's a bit of a scattershot all over the place. And I want to let Richard talk about this.
Yeah, no textbooks. Everything is packet-based. So our instructors obviously know their textbooks and they may pull an idea of a repertoire from XYZ anthology or something, but this is also for student cost. So there's a packet that they do have to buy that we get, you know, at the bookstore, but it's put together by our instructors and there's no specific textbook to go with. So they teach all of the theory and history just, you know, out of the context of the repertoire that is in the packet.
Do any of you folks use Sight Refactory for first year?
I've heard good things, but no, I don't.
Yeah, it's spectacular.
Okay.
Sight Refactory. Yeah. We just buy a license for everyone, so it's free for kids, and it's just an unending loop of exercise. It's
great.
Fantastic. All we have to do is do
it. I think Richard mentioned this. You have a 3-semester core and then a elective in theory, a fourth semester that they choose?
Well, the fourth semester is, I'll say it this way, we have three semesters of theory. The third semester of theory, that same course doubles as 20th century history because we're looping those topics back around on each other.
Okay.
And then the fourth semester, so their second semester sophomore year, they will take Common Practice Masterworks, which is Baroque Classical. And then later in the sequence, there's an early music class they take junior year where we do chant and those things. So we kind of flipped the whole thing.
Oh, I was just going to say, in Theory 4, we have adopted the sequence that a lot of other institutions have, where Theory 4 is now a modular class. So our vocal majors, for example, can take analysis of song, or if students really want that 20th and 21st century repertoire, like we have a lot of composers on the faculty who specialize in that. They can take that class with them if they want to compose something. Focus on composition, they can take a composition class, and I'm teaching the popular music analysis class that anyone can take, but our popular music majors really enjoy. So yeah, the modular fourth semester allows students to have a little bit more agency in the things that they want to study that, you know, they might not get and they often complain about in theory one and two. It's like, why are we studying X? It's like, well, if you hang on, just hang on. you might get to dive into something you really enjoy in theory four.
Options independence. You're the last question we can take.
Oh,
make it a good one.
I hope it's a good one. I'm just thinking, wow, this is awesome. How do you have trouble with transfer students? If you're
Yes, because this is kind of unique. Also, whether they're coming from a two-year school or from another four-year institution, yes. There's vocabulary issues, there's like their leveling isn't quite the right thing because maybe they did okay in the abstract content but not oral skills, and so yeah, that's very, very tricky.
I currently have students that I forget which class they're in. I have a student that's in, we have theory, we have like, for example, Music 1A, which is the theory course, and Music 1B, which is the RLS course, they're separate. I have a student currently now in, he's a transfer student, he's currently in 3B, but 1A, so go figure that out. We have some changing to do, but up to this point, we've gotten through a few hurdles like that, but I think we need to change some of our policies. It's challenging.
And I'd say that it depends on where they're transferring from for us. Theory is articulated in the Maricopa Community Colleges, which feed into the three state institutions and other institutions in Arizona. And that flows easily. But if somebody's taken theory and they took the first year and then they stayed at their other institution for a while and then they come in, it's use it or lose it, right? It's like a foreign language, so they need to often work hard to remind themselves of what they learned 2 years ago before, if they haven't had their full complement theory. So, thank you all so much for being so attentive. And